Kwa sasa tuna pokea maswali matatu kutoka kwa audience. Naona mmeinua mikono sana. Nichukue nikiangazia agenda, nichukue nyuma naulize swali moja, la pili kwako na la tatu kwa yule aliinua akiwa wa kwanza, alafu tutaendelea na maswali pia.
Thank you very much, Mr. Makenge. My name is Sarah Marengu Karigi, Accounti Maendeleo Wanawake Leader. This is an observation, Mr. Mwakazi. None of the six gubernatorial candidates picked a woman for running mate in Embu County. Is it because women have not been learned, or is it because traditionally women have no place in a county or in a tradition?
Thank you so much.
My name is Martin. I want to request a comment. Many of their ways. This collection, we have tried to do that work for our life. So my best, can we get a plant to recycle degradable and degradable waste? The other question is about an ICT center.
One question.
The ICT center. All the data, all the problems can be solved under data. Only that. Thank you.
My name is Peter Mushangi Ireni. I'm the chairperson of Embu County Urban Forum. And my question is actually urban focused. We know that the world is fast urbanizing, and Kenya is no exception. Neither is Embu County an exception. Now, any of you could be our next governor, and I would wish to know from you, our laws allow for formation of urban management boards. This has not been achieved by many counties. Reason, we don't know. What do you think, or would you consider formation of urban management boards critical to your administration if you were lucky to get our votes in Embu County?
So thank you so much. The questions are very clear. Perhaps we could start with Jagi, the question on women. How do you intend to engage women in your administration?
Very democratic state or country where people should be free to choose somebody they feel will be able to assist them. We know in the last election, the governor had a woman who was deputy governor as a running mate. So it does not mean that women have been left out. Again, we have been having a woman who did not even go for the running mate. She went for the top seat, but somehow she lost at the nomination. In Kirinyaga, who are our neighbors here, the top contenders for the governor's seat are two women, two iron ladies. I think let's give people freedom to choose a running mate of their choice, because I don't think there's any discrimination.
Probably the question would be, in your administration, how do you intend to engage women in the management of
the government? I have a constitution, which I feel is very, very clear. When did it come to appointments?
Out of 'All the appointments must be very, very gender sensitive, and our constitution is very clear on that, that two-thirds, you should not have more than two-thirds of one gender. In fact, where we are now, we are likely to be having more problems of men than women. We know 75% of the homes now, they are headed by women. So actually, we also need to start propping men up. The time when we are propping women, I think we propped them, they reached where they have reached, and actually we need to look at the men also. I don't think there was any conspiracy. I never consulted KK, I never consulted Leonard. We never sat anywhere down as men and decided that we pick our animate as men. I think it's just a question of a coincidence. I don't think there's any harm meant to women, and we shall try our level best to ensure that they get key position in our government.
You are faced that way. Sarah, you know that women already are the power behind the throne in them. Although we elected a man, it's women who are running this M.
just a moment, I'll give you time. Kindly request the audience to please observe the rules that we are not supposed to clap within this particular session till the very end. Thank you so much. Obviously, your 2 minutes begin.
So what they have counted is protection from an unvolatility of women. And we therefore needed to make sure that the government we are forming is protected from that and police treatment. And if I can answer the other question about CPOs and recycling and the upper, shall I answer the 3 questions quickly?
Good.
Right? Pana Mushang, you asked about urban development. I'm sure you have read the Kenya urban development review. That's why you asked me this question. It is true. The future of the county, very much depends on how we do urban planning and urban management. And the World Bank and many donors and the national government has done a program on that, national urban development. I can only say I'm lucky because I've been at the center of a program which the World Bank and the government has been developing, for which the World Bank will actually next week, 25th, the World Bank will approve a $300 million program for Kenya to do urban development. I tell you what, help count the people, only counting governments which do have accountability, which have integrity in how they run their counties, will have a cent of that 300 billion Kenyan shillings. That is the challenge for M County leadership of the future. And for that reason, that is one of the reasons I visited the current governor of Embu, sent by the World Bank sometime last year. So there is money for urban development. And in fact, all governments which do not do what we are suggesting, Mr. Mushangi, will not have a single coin of that money. Finally, in terms of recycling, that has been asked. As I said, if you use new technology, what is solid waste will become solid opportunity. And in terms of data center, yes, we need to do GPUs and so on for our youth in different places, including not using the formal education system. Thank you.
Thank you. First, I think it's a coincidence, Madam Sarah, that we don't have a female running mate. And for me, really, I come from, I represent the already marginalized, if I look at youth. So for me, it was also a technical feeling that you have youth, women, and the disabled as one category, and being a youth and being running for governor, I felt it's good now to also represent the others who are not marginalized, because I represent that category, youth, women, and the disabled as the governor. So the other thing is definitely in my administration, we will ensure that power is given to women. Actually, no single gender will be more than 2/3. So you can actually tell Maendeleo ya Wanawake that they are safe under Leonard, so nothing to worry, it's just a coincidence. The other thing on recycling, definitely those are very good thoughts, Martin, and there are many counties which are planning to do this. So we cannot have, let's say, waste management, producing energy through waste in every county, because some it needs to make sense as well. So we are going to also look at our waste and see if we can have our plant here. If not, we can actually sell it to counties like Nairobi, which are already going, have already signed agreements to have solid management centers where they are going to be producing energy. Data center, definitely, I've promised free Wi-Fi in market centers. Right now, we have cloud storage and all that, so definitely, I see that. On urban development,
thank you. Thank you so much, and I really appreciate that. I want to ask a follow-up question to Kivinji, especially regarding women and, of course, the issue of youth and people with disabilities. According to the Public Procurement Regulatory Authority, a plan to give youth, women, and the disabled 30% of all government tenders has been all talk and little action. And I feel saddest question, in as much as it was pointed to running mates, it also points to so many other issues in terms of even giving tenders and procurement. What focus in your government, if you become governor, to make sure that even procurement tenders become accessible?
Two things. The first thing is to eliminate corruption in the process. Because at the moment, even youths who could do some jobs, they cannot apply for them because they are required to give a kickback before they have even started the job. So if you are given a job for $1 million, you need to give 100,000 shillings first, you cannot do the job. So that is the first thing that has to be done for the youth and the women and even the disabled to take advantage. We must bring integrity, we must do away with oversight, with rushwa, katika procurement process. If that is not done, the youth will just be there as sideshows. And even now, a lot of contracts which are given to youth, they are not done by the youth. The youth's name is used, but the job is done by somebody else who has done the first bribing, who has financed the bribing for him. So we know that has to be eliminated. The second thing is that we got to comply with the law as it is at the moment. And in fact, let me again say that there is already a program of 20 billion shillings, 200 billion shillings by the World Bank, which would be used by county governments to do a lot of other things. But only 5 county governments in the last 2 years, in their own country, have used that money because there is no integrity, there is no transparency in those counties. Therefore, those counties which do not meet that rule of that percent for youth, women, and so on, they are even sacrificing other money coming to their county government. Therefore, that should be the first thing you do. When I talk about cleaning the mess in every county, that is the first mess which needs to be cleaned, so that the youth can have their due share, the women can have their due share, the disabled can have their due share, and more importantly, the children from poor families, the youth from poor families, can have their fair share. Thank you.
Definitely corruption is an issue. I've actually promised 50%, not 30%, because it's doable. The law only sets a lower limit. We can even give 100% to the youth. But of course, with other members of society are also important. When I say, maybe I'll use the disadvantage being the youth, women, and the disabled. One thing that I've promised to do is ensure that tenders are restricted by ward. So this will actually ensure that the youth in a particular ward, if it's a project for that ward, they get it in that ward. I've actually promised millionaires in every ward. That's what I want to be get by after 5 years. And I do proper empowerment. There is no point of giving someone a contract they are not able to do. There is no need of advertising a tender, calling it a youth tender, yet the youth or women or the disabled will not be capable. So in our polytechnics, under my administration, we are going to have wealth management, wealth creation and management as a key and a compulsory course even for Mama Mboga, as we move away from doing business for daily bread to doing business with a vision to grow, and giving these tenders now to these people who already know that I'm starting from 300,000 shillings tender, aiming for a 10 million tender. The other thing, of course, is to ensure that we involve banks, we involve other equipment owners, so that when you're giving a tender to a youth, you're also giving undertaking to these people to do business with the young people. Because that is the role of empowerment. Empowerment means you get someone from a position of not being able to a position of being able. And there is a process to that, which I've really outlined in my manifesto, giving undertaking so that people can actually even lend to a youth who has nothing in the expectation that the country will pay them.
Right, thank you so much. Now that the issue of corruption has been brought up, this question goes to Njagi. But according to the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission, there was actually a report in March. The Embu County government last year rubbished a report by the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission, ranking it as second in graft index in the country. So already we've been, as Embu County, in bad books. When you become governor, what are the practical steps you're going to take to clear? Exactly.
There's that report from ESCC. There's also a report from the Controller of Budget, which have all been indicating that Embu has been very poorly. 2014, they did better than Tana River. Tana River, we knew there was a Beketoni and Saba attack, and nothing was going on. And then Embu became number 46 out of 47. The same thing was repeated in 2015, 2016, and I believe we are almost at the same level. So the corruption level is very high in Embu. We are very much ashamed of that. That corruption level also gave a report on bribery, and we became number one in Kenya. That to get anything in Kenya, even if you need to get a school bursary, you have to pay some money for you to get the bursary. So the people who deserve don't get it because they have not been able to get the required amount. And that is why we are having problems with the disabled. Although we say that a percent, they are not able to give a kickback. I think that is very unfortunate. My government will be based on zero tolerance. I have held administrative positions. I told you I was the director of health in Embu. I've also been a director of health running Mathare Hospital. I've handled government funds, and I have never been corrupt. So I want to set an example of a corrupt-free government. Because with corruption, we cannot get anywhere. Let me add, the business of a government is not to do business. We are talking about giving some tenders. The tenders are meant to run an affair. So I believe the tenders actually should be given to the people who do not have. You have no business assisting a rich man to get richer. They know how to get rich. In my government, I'll be more concerned with the up-and-coming businessmen so that I promote them and they're able to move.
We now move on to Bwana KK. The question on formation of urban boards.
Oh, sorry, maybe it was, I was not clear, talking in a hurry. What I said is that there's a program developed now by the government of Kenya and the World Bank in consultation with the Council of Governors, which program has 300 billion shillings from the World Bank, which makes it that if a county government is being well run and starts the process of establishing urban bonds, it will share in that 300 billion shilling thing.
those county governments which do not do it, which do not create urban roads and so forth, and many have not done so because of the opportunities of stealing money collected in the city center, in the cities and in the towns and cities. Those counties which do not do it will not have any access to any of that money. So I would say that there is a very clear incentive for county governments everywhere. Any county government which is led by a serious governor is going to establish urban roads because there will be money for it in billions to invest in the urban centers. I would just want to say one thing in addition to what Mr. Jaria said about corruption. The first thing which the next governor of every county needs to do is to clean the mess of corruption in this county government. And the only way you start is by breaking down the corruption networks, which have been deliberately developed and institutionalized, put in place by the current leadership of the county government. Every money is not being stolen or lost by chance. It is being stolen through deliberate action. Talking about urban bonds, most of the money collected in this town does not end up in the exchequer or in the bank account of the county government. It ends up in somebody's residence, in some other people's pockets. That is the beginning of developing even a viable urban board. So those are issues which here need to be addressed.
Urban management boards, yes, Bwana Mushangi has set up, and not just for the sake of it, but empowered boards that will also be involved in planning and approvals. Because the reason you asked a very good question, we don't know why, because it actually makes sense to do it. And it's because the current administration, and it's actually many counties, they want to keep secrets. Because when you have secrets, then you have room to keep stealing from the public. But I will have empowered boards that will actually be also involved in setting up rates and approvals, like I said, so that we plan for this city, because we are talking of a few residents now in Embu. It's projected to reach millions in the next few years, so we have to be prepared for that. Corruption is a big issue. Bwana Mokazi, you asked about it. And I think actually in this county, corruption is a department that has targets, and that's why we are number two. And this is really sad. So my administration definitely will have very practical ways of dealing with the corruption, starting with our revenue collection. I've said even where we have cess points, we are going to have CCTV, solar-controlled CCTV cameras. We are going to have zero cash in my administration. By October, we will have a bank as a partner that any citizen can actually know how much we collected on by the 30th of every month. Daily, you can actually see what we are collecting, and we'll be accounting for money that you're aware of. Of course, a lot of corruption in the tender system. There was a joke about Lipa Kama tender just the other day. Our tenders will be awarded within 2 weeks, very promptly, so that we eliminate. When you create delays, then you create room for corruption. When we advertise, we evaluate immediately after opening, and we are awarded within 2 weeks, leaving no room for our officials to engage in fishy business.
Why do you think installing CCTVs will help in curbing those vices other than...
The simplest way to fight corruption is have a memo, which is always done. I think if you go to every government office, the first board they put is, this is a corruption-free zone. But we know that doesn't work. What we know works is institutions. And because we are coming from a very needy position, we are actually, we have people who thrive in corruption. So the monitoring is actually very important. And I have a case example, because I've worked with many county governments in policy formulation, especially in health, where collection at a district hospital in Kakamega County went up by 10 times by installing CCTV cameras at the cashier's desk. So this actually works. When someone knows they are being watched, if they are supposed to collect 100 shillings, they collect 100 shillings, not 50 bob, and then give a receipt. People actually have their own receipts. So yes, Makenge, when you're talking of sand in Kiambere, there is an officer who is collecting. We need to make sure that that road is good so that sand is affordable and the farmer gets good, I mean the sand harvester gets good money. And the only way is to ensure that what we collect gets to the county. Yes, we will have solar-powered CCTV cameras at the cess point so that every lorry that moves out with sand pays and pays the correct amount.
What agenda do you have for
drones? Drones are very important for any development to take place on a sustainable basis. What I can say is that we have enough money under the county government. If we dedicated 20%, which is a billion shillings every year, to doing the roads in our countryside, even roads which you think should not be tarmacked, which you are not dreaming of tarmacking today, will be tarmacked. And therefore, it is clear that especially the roads which connect the wards and the constituencies, those which are not in the national government program should be tarmacked as soon as yesterday to the extent that the money will be available. And I think it will be a question of priorities by different constituencies, by different wards, what roads they need to be tarmacked and which ones do not need to be tarmacked. But let me say again, it is not like we have had, not had used a lot of money on roads. The problem has been to use a lot of money on roads, and again, even the women in the village know. You go to the women in the village, they tell you our road was supposedly marammed, but only three lorries of maram were part of that road. And then you were told the road has been marammed, and even a big signpost was put to say that the road has been marammed. But the moram was only 5 lorries, but obviously the road needed 200 lorries to maram it. You ask yourself, where did the other 108 lorries of maram go? So the biggest problem for our roads at the moment, if you use just the current budget for roads that the county government is using, you would tarmac a lot of roads and virtually our roads would be marammed. But at the moment, only 1/5 at the most of that money goes to actually work. The rest of money is put into the pockets of some women and some men, a few of them.
Some issues, some brutality between the national and the county government. Yeah. Right here, I'm seeing the county ring road, the Embu County ring road. Yeah. And some issues between the county government and the national government, where the county had begun to talk.
This is an area that has been very much removed. I'm actually a chairman of an elders council called Mayima Council of Elders, and we have been looking at some of the issues which affect the welfare of Embu residents negatively. The ring road is classified as a national government road, and the construction by the county government, because we need that ring road badly, but the county does not have the kind of money which can construct that road. And when the county government started constructing, they applied for a loan of 4 billion and they were supposed to raise 10%. And then the 90% was supposed to be a loan from a bank which we are going to pay for the next 15 years. And one of the people said it does not make economic sense to get a loan to construct a road which the national government is ready to construct from the national kitty. And actually it got a bit of a backing and that thing has been stopped.
I think this was really abuse of the office, because they are doing a job which they are not supposed to do. So I think we are happy, I feel proud. I'm part of the group of people who decided we don't get along. And actually that ring road is being constructed by the national government, and they're all moving around in NASA and Jupiter. We want them to come and tell us what they've done. And they're not telling us they're doing the road. So I still stand by that, that the national road should be constructed by the national government. The county roads should be constructed by the county government.
Thank you so much. Shukran. Kidogo kuna mzee wetu aliuliza swali pale kuhusu jinsi labda serikali yenu itaweza kuwahusisha wale ambao wametoka kwenye vitongoji duni kabisa. Labda tuanze kwako ili mzee wetu pia ahisi tumemtambua. Bwana Lena, hebu mjibu moja kwa moja.
Bwana mzee Mwenda nasema pia ni mhubiri, nasema watu wanaotoka kwa vitongoji duni wanahitaji kwamba kupatiwa nafasi sawa na wale wengine. Hii mambo ya ubaguzi haifai kuwa, lakini unajua viongozi wengi hawataki watu wajiendeleze. Kuna wale viongozi wanapenda wakati umebaki maskini ndio kila mwaka miaka tano ikiisha na kutumia vibaya. Kwa hivyo mimi nimeshasema, ukiona nikisema mambo ya youth, kama ni kina mama, kama ni wazee, nasema kuhusu youth wote, haijalishi kama mtu ametoka kwa slum, kama ako, kama tukifanya kazi Shauri Moyo Kadita, huko project ya huko kama ni ya kuweka stima itafanywa na vijana wa pale. Kwa hivyo hiyo itasaidia kuonyesha watu kwamba sio lazima ukue unatoka mtaa wa Bluval ili upate kazi kwa serikali ya Embu County. Kama unatoka kwa slum pia utakuwa na nafasi sawa na wale viongozi wale wengine kutoka sehemu zingine.
Mwenda, nataka tu kusema tabu moja ya slum ni wakaji wa huko, wakati mwingine hawataki hata kufikiria kuhama. Kile niamamisha sana ni kwamba itakuwa nafuu sana kuwapatia watoto wenu nafasi ya kuishi mahali ingine kuliko pale. Na ndipo nikazungumzia juu ya kuanzisha mji mpya wa Embu County ambapo vijana wanaweza kupata ajira na makazi, kwa kufungua njia mpya katika Kenya ya kutumiwa na watalii wa Kenya. Kwa sababu kwa sasa kuna njia nne katika Kenya za watalii, tunataka ya tano iwe katika kaunti yetu ya Embu. La pili, swali langu pia linahusiana na swali lililoulizwa na Catherine juu ya watoto wenu kutoweza kuendesha masomo vizuri. Na kwa hivyo kuna umuhimu sana kuhakikisha kwamba watoto kutoka familia ambazo ziko katika slums wanasaidiwa kwa njia special ili waendelee na masomo kama watoto wengine. Thank you.
Let me add that to get people from the slums, they are human beings and they are entitled to live. Food is a basic human right, water and shelter, those are basic human rights. And I think every government, what we call a government, should look at those deprived members of the community, because some of them are deprived because of various issues. I think we should be able to identify those who have not been able to manage their lives. Just like we are having some money for the elderly, we should be able to identify those who are threatened, those who are very poor, and the government should be able to subsidize their living. Just like they do in the developed world, this welfare fund, let's look at those people who are really in need, and we help them to live like other human beings. And of course, if we ensure that they get education, the bursaries you don't have to buy, like now they are buying, that's what is making them very desperate. So if we give them basic human needs, I think they should be able to come up.
Asante sana. Tribalism and clanism is becoming an issue each and every day, especially as we approach 8th of August. Yeah. Embu residents are getting divided each and every day in terms of tribal and clan basis. Bwana Leonard.
Well, this is actually a big issue because there are some leaders who want to use it for their own selfish.
In fact, even now, what are you doing to fight?
Yes. What I'm doing now is I'm positioning myself as a young man from Embu. I'm not positioning myself as from a particular ethnic community. Of course, there is where I come from, but that has no basis because to get where I am, it's not because of my tribe or my clan or my father or my mother. They did their part to get me to school, but the rest I think I hustled. What I'm doing now, like I said, is to position myself as one belonging to one tribe called the youth, one belonging to one clan called the youth, because hakuna shida ya mtu wa Embu ama mtu wa Mbere, mtu wa Ukambani ama tukipata shida, wakati tunaongea hizi shida zote hapa, kila mwananchi wa Embu anaumia. Kwa hivyo hakuna siku utapata kuna shida ya Mwembu na shida ya Mbere. Kwa hivyo hatufai kugawanyishwa ama shida ya Mkamba. Mimi serikali yangu itagawa nafasi za kazi sawa kwa kila mtu, haitaonyesha ukabila ama hii mambo ya ukoo. Na hiyo ndio njia moja ambayo tukifika uchaguzi mwingine, kila mtu atakuwa ameona ukoo wako haukusaidii, kabila lako haikusaidii. Ile tunaangalia ni qualification yako ama ni manufaa gani utaleta kwa kaunti yetu, ndio tunakupatia kazi ama mambo mengine. Nakumbuka nimesema tenda zangu za ward zitapewana kwa ward. Kwa hivyo wale watu wa pale hawatatoka wakienda sehemu nyingine kung'ang'ania kazi za watu wengine. So hiyo itaonyesha mtu kwamba haijalishi mahali unapotoka, kabila lako ama ukoo kwa serikali yangu.
In 1 minute, wanna comment on this issue?
I've actually been involved in trying to make sure there's no clansing or tribalism in Embu. And I started this one even before the last general election, when I called the elders in that meeting in Siakago, which decided let's try to do a bit of guided democracy to ensure no community is left out of the government. Because a government is not a company which is limited by shares. A government is for the people. So you have to make sure people are represented in this government. In that meeting, actually, we sent the governor come from Embu and the senator from Mbere, and it worked. And even right now, if I get a chance to be the governor, I will ensure that the regions are represented in the government, the various clans are represented, so that we don't have a government which is skewed towards one region or one community. I believe if we do it practically, then clansing, tribalism will be a thing of the past.
I think part of the problem at the moment is the current government, by employing people selectively, by engaging people from some places of the county and leaving out some sub-tribes and employing others, has obviously exacerbated the sense of tribalism in the county. Therefore, the first responsibility which we have, even as candidates, is to make sure that we reflect the sense of an inclusive government. We should reflect it now, we should reflect it when we form the next government. When we form the government, this should not be a government of the Embus without the Mberes, or without the Kambas, or without the Kikuyus, or without any other important group that lives in this county. We have to have an inclusive government. That is the only way we shall have unity and the peace to realize development in Embu. And I can say it is part of the potential tragedy of this county that actually we can make the mistake of forming a government, of electing a leader who is already showing very clear signs of partisanship, of being tribal and so forth. That is something which every community must run away from, like they would run away from any other plague. I would just like to add and say that by having an inclusive government,
it does mean therefore you have to have inclusiveness. And therefore it is important that we have a county development forum which goes beyond elected leaders. This includes everybody else.
Salamu alaikum. Shukran, shukran. Asanteni, sasa tumefika mwisho.
Ni jambo muhimu sana kwa sababu unajua wakati mimi nataka kuambia elders kama vijana watuonyeshe utangamano. Wakati wanakutana mkutano wanaanza kusema sijui gavana atoke Embu, senator atoke mbele. Hiyo tayari ni kuonyesha kwamba hatuko watu, hatuko kitu kimoja. Kwa hivyo mimi nataka kusema hiyo mikutano ya kusema huyu akue hii ama akue hii, hiyo ni kitu haifai. Wacha sisi tuchague yule governor anayetufaa kama watu wote, sio kusema hii kiti ni ya huyu, hii kiti ni ya huyu. Hapo ndio shida inaanzia. Nilitaka tu kusema hivyo.
Nashukuru, tumefika mwisho, lakini kabla tumalizie, tungependa sasa nyinyi kama viongozi muweze kuulizana swali moja tu. Sasa nikauliza kama wewe sasa tutaanza na Bwana Kivinji. Utamuuliza swali moja. Chagua Lena ama utachagua Bwana Njagi? Chagua ni nani? Swali moja utamuuliza kwa dakika moja. Na ukishamaliza yule ambaye utakayemuuliza atapata dakika moja pia kujibu. Tuanze moja kwa moja na Bwana Kivinji. Utamuuliza nani?
Utamuuliza Bwana Komanda. Nimuuliza kwa sababu amesuluhishia hayo mambo, hiyo kazi alikuwa anafanya ya kuunganisha wa watu wa Embu County. Umefanikiwa mpaka hapo?
Ama labda unapoendelea kufikiria tutampa Lena nafasi amuulize mwenzake swali moja pia. Yote yule.
Mimi nitamuuliza Bwana KK ambaye namheshimu sana. Mimi nataka kuuliza, nikiangalia billboard zake zote ama message zote inasema vijana wakuwe empowered. Sasa mimi naona njia moja ni kuachia vijana usikane. Usiseme ndio kutosha.
Nitauliza Bwana KK, kulingana na vile watu wanaongea, amesema amekuwa kwa siasa muda mrefu sana, kutoka 1993. Anaona kama wakati huyu kuna tofauti itatokea, sababu amejaribu mara mingi.
Asante, nashukuru sana. Sasa tutaanza moja kwa moja na Bwana Kivinji ajibu maswali mawili ambayo anaulizwa.
Nitaanza ya kwanza na mwanzo kwa Bwana Njagi. Mr. Njagi, I tried politics when I was in my 30s and that was before 1993. The last time I contested elections before 2013 was 1988 against Kamili Muli. And the next time I did elections was 2013, 25 years later. For 25 years, I was not involved in the politics of Embu, but by grace of God, I was very much involved in the development of Embu. Therefore, the people of Embu have never thought of me as being out of politics, but I never contested any election from 1998 to 2013, 25 years. I only came back to politics because after the professionals of Embu County and leaders of Embu County, including religious leaders, saw me leading them in having a shared vision for the county, all of them, without exception, maybe except you, asked me to become the governor of Embu. Right? That is the only reason why I came back. And on that note, therefore, I lost the fight. Now, the second question. From Kijana Governor Asimila. Let me say two things.
One, Leonard, sincerely, if I had any inkling, you know you are new in Embu. We have never seen you in Embu until you have come to contest for this election. Because you have, if you had been a chairman of a board of governors of a school in Embu, I would have met you. If you had been a chairman of a cooperative society in Embu or a youth group, I would have met you. If I had any inkling whatsoever that actually you can do this job of delivering people of Embu County from poverty and removing unemployment from Embu, I would happily and gracefully step aside.
Sasa kwa sababu umeulizwa swali lolote.
Can I answer the question I was asked? Or we start with Leonard?
Sijaulizwa swali kwa sababu labda wanajua nitajibu vizuri sana. Nataka kusema kwamba kusema sijakuwa Embu, unajua kuna hiyo kitu inasemwa lakini ni uongo. Nataka niseme sio watu wengi sana wanaweza fika mahali nimefika hapa Embu. Opportunities zile zimekuwa Embu sio za kunifikisha mahali niko. Lakini nikaona mimi kwanza niache shughuli zangu nikuje hapa ndio nione vile vijana wa Embu wanaweza fika mahali nimefika kutokana na opportunities zenye ziko Embu. Kwa sababu Embu iko na opportunities mingi sana za hizo cottage industries na tourism. Ingine ya kusema ni hizo, mimi nimekuwa mentor wa vijana wengi sana Embu, mambo ya talent, na nafikiri kama mzee KK alikuwa anahusika sana na mambo kama ya talent kwa vijana, angenijua Leonard Muriuki. Kwa hivyo sijatoka mbali ndio nirudi ati hapa Embu kuuliza kitu. Mimi nimezaliwa hapa, nafanya kazi na vijana wa hapa, na nitaendelea kukua hapa na nitazikwa hapa.
Asante. Naona bwana Kithinji angependa kujibu lakini nitakupa nafasi baada ya bwana Njagi.
I was asked whether my efforts to unite the communities living in Embu bore fruit. Let me first of all say, by the time I was trying to unite Embu and Bered, there's a time Embu and Bered were living in one district, which was called Embu County, which was called Embu District. Then the Bereds got their district. And by that time, it was very acrimonious. Because when they were separated was because you need to have your own district, you be independent people, these Embus are taking advantage of you. So this was a project to heal what was there. A lot of suspicion between the Embus and the Bereds. And it worked, because actually, like the senator who was from Bered got very many votes from Embu. So we were able to bring Embu and Bered people together. And even now, there's no conflict between the Bereds and the Embus. We regard ourselves as brothers. And in fact, those who have complained about tribalism, they have complained about six people, six leaders. They have not blamed everybody. So the common man, we are very much together. It is the leaders who have got conflict.
Asante. Tukupa nafasi dakika moja tu pale.
Yeah, I was just going to really, sincerely tell you, Kijana Governor, kwamba in this town of Embu and in this county, I have done more for youth talents than anybody else. The number of functions of youth that I've sponsored in this town, whether it is musical, whether it is fashion show, in this town, my friend, it'll take another 5 years to catch up. Thank you.
Asante sana bwana. Sasa nawahakikishia tena mweze kupeana closing remarks. In 1 minute, starting with you, Leonard.
Ningetaka kushukuru kwa hii nafasi, nishukuru wale waliopanga hii debate, manake nafikiri tumepata nafasi hata kama imekuwa ni kidogo kueleza sera zetu. Na nataka niseme kwamba watu ambao wanakaa Embu, ambao wametusikiza na wanajua ile mahali Embu inafaa iende, tayari wako na kiongozi wao. Kila mtu hapa anajua na anaelewa ni nani anahitaji kuwa kiongozi. Tumeona hata kwa kaunti nyingi ambazo ziko na governors vijana ndio zinaongoza, sio kwa corruption lakini kwa maendeleo. Kwa hivyo mimi nataka tu kuambia watu wa Embu, msingoje mpaka ati Leonard arudi kuuliza kiti akiwa 65 years ndio mchague. Labda hiyo nafasi itatokea. Achagueni mtu ambaye anaweza fanya hii kazi, kwa sababu kazi ya CEO, hata ukiangalia katika organizations mingi wanachagua watu ambao ni vijana, na ni kwa sababu hii kazi inataka nidhani dakika tatu. Kazi inataka nguvu, inataka vision, na inataka mtu ambaye atakuwa sio kila saa anaamshwa ndio aende kufanya kazi.
Asante sana kwa hiyo.
Nitasema kwamba kama nilivyosema hapo awali, mimi naona my mission is to get the help call the people Embu County on the front line of development in Kenya. I want Embu County to be the first county to show Kenya poverty can be eradicated. I want to be the first county in Kenya to show that we can have programs, we can have an economic system which can take our youth to a next level, which can address the problems of youth unemployment and youth unsettlement. I will say are five key things that I think I want them to do. The first thing, which is a priority for this county government, is water, for health of our children and for people to do better. We need to do better in terms of agricultural productivity and also better marketing and variation of our crops. More serious work in terms of dairy farming, more serious work in terms of irrigation. We should take virtually all our money there. It will create jobs for our youth. It will change the economy of this country totally. I want to add that we need to create a new tourist corridor for Kenya to pass through Embu County, because God has blessed us with that opportunity. That way again, we are building a county which is different from everybody else, and that way we shall be fast enough. And finally, please, let us clean the mess which is Embu County today. Because Embu County today is a mess. We don't have a county government.
Thank you.
The governor, the seat of the governor is very important because he's the chief executive of the county. We all know that if the leading ship leaks, the others will not eat grass. So let's not just pick someone like that. Let's look at the track record of that person, whether he is actually capable for the job he wants to get. Let's see whether this person is selfless. Is he there to serve himself or to serve the community? We also need to get somebody with a dilemma to do this job. And the most important thing, he must not be corrupt. We have been number two on corruption in the whole of Kenya, and we have to make sure the next CEO of this country is not corrupt. I'm proud of my track record. I've held positions. I've never been involved or mentioned in any corrupt deal. So I humbly ask you on 8 August to give me that chance, and I'll bring a change compared to the government we have now, a community change.
Asante. Pia mimi kwa upande wangu na rudisha shukrani sana sababu ya kujitokeza kwenu na pia kukoparate sababu sijaona behaviors mbaya, si ndio? Tumekuwa tunaendelea vizuri. Na nafikiri kama wana county tafadhali, tuendelee hivyo hivyo. Wacha tukue watu wa amani, wa kupendana sana, wa kuishi pamoja, sababu hao watu wapite ama wasipite, ukweli ni kwamba Embu itaishi. Ukweli ni kwamba wewe na ndugu yako mtaishi. Ukweli ni kwamba anaweza kusaidia mahali pengine wewe haungeweza kujisaidia. Ukweli ni kwamba yeye anaweza kusaidiwa na wewe mahali yeye angeweza kujisaidia. Sawa sawa.
asanteni sana. Si tuko na nyinyi hapa. Kana tigo. Tuseme ni kivyele ya roli. Asanteni sana.
Nashukuru asanteni sana. Na pia tunaomba itakapofika Agosti tarehe ngapi? Sote tutakwenda kupiga kura. Na tukishamaliza tutafanya nini? Tutakwenda nyumbani kwa amani, lakini tena tukijua mtu fulani amechaguliwa, tutafanya nini? Si tutakuja pamoja? Tufanye kazi kwa pamoja.
When did you come?